Hi everybody, I'm Mathilde van den Berg from the University of Groningen, and I will be presenting my master thesis results about developing a two-fern eruption pattern scheme to estimate age of death in reindeer based on recent populations from Svalbard. In zooarchaeology, understanding the mortality patterns of animals is very important to gain insight into ancient hunting, management, and husbandry practices. And the aging methods based on the dental wear and eruption patterns are of great significance because they are relatively quick, they're also non-destructive, and they're also very cheap. And this method already proved its accuracy in several other studies and also for cervid species. Aging methods based on dental wear and eruption patterns do exist for reindeer, but they're don't exist in the form of an easy-to-use scheme, such as the famous one for sheep and goat by Grant from 1982, which you can see on the screen. And this one is widely used. Also, the methods for reindeer have been criticized for their very shortcomings. For example, there's a high degree of subjectivity, or they promote very narrow age classes, which they can't hold up to when tested. And some studies on reindeer mortality even resort to using sheep-goat schemes because they are so easy to use. And this really shows the urgency of developing a new, cheap, easy way to estimate age of death in reindeer. And this study sought to establish an easy-to-use, high-accuracy two-fern eruption pattern scheme to estimate age of death of reindeer based on the dental aging of Svalbard reindeer. And for this I used recent populations from Svalbard and blind tests on researchers with different levels of experience. And I had several sub-questions and I will only talk about 1.5 because there is not enough time. I will talk about how easy is it for both experienced and inexperienced users to use a scheme, and what is the deviation of the estimated actual age when the scheme is applied to a biological assemblage of known age. And what can we learn from this? So I will first give you a little bit of theoretical background. Aging of mammals on the base of tooth eruption is possible because the deciduous teeth get replaced in a settled sequence and mostly also related to settled ages, although there's an age range. And the aging of reindeer on the base of tooth patterns is possible because reindeer have selenodont teeth, which means that they have dentine and enamel infoldings in their teeth, and when the tooth wears away, you can see it in the result as a pattern. And previous studies have showed a strong correlation between age and tooth wear in eruption patterns, although there is also a range. Sizable osteological collections are pretty rare, but I wanted to use the reindeer mandibles of known age for several reasons, and one of them being that an established method can then be tested for age justification. So for this study, two modern known age collections of Svalbard reindeer were identified, and they were aged through the counting of the cemental anomaly and also the eruption patterns. The first is a collection of mandibles from animals from the 6 hunting areas in the Northern Skald region. And I visited the collection and I looked at 314 mandibles of 162 animals of known age. And I wanted to preferably study at least 10 mandibles inside every age class and also 3 mandibles for every sex, because then you can assess the tooth wear variation inside the sexes and inside an age class. But for the older age categories, because it ranges from 0 years to 17 years, there weren't so many mandibles, so this wasn't possible. But till about 13 or 14 years of age, this was possible. And the second collection is a collection of mandibles collected from the reindeer's winter range on Etzea by the Netherlands Spitsbergen expedition of 1968-1969. And here I looked at 61 mandibles of known age, But in the process of counting the semantic anomaly, the first molar was destructed. But this is not a problem because I wanted to test the scheme on this collection. And normally, in archaeological samples, there will also be some teeth missing. So it's actually a good practice. All the mandibles from the Northern Scald collection were examined for eruption patterns and tooth wear. The molars from teeth of the mandibles in age classes ranging from 0 to 3 years were assessed on the state of eruption. And for this, I followed the codes of Ewbank et al. Of 1964. For example, the C stands for the perforation in crypt visible. And you can see an example on the screen. Oh yeah, and for the assessment of tooth wear, I looked at the dentine enamel patterning of the occlusal surface, so that's the upper surface of the teeth of the deciduous premolar 4, of the premolar 4, the first molar, second molar, and third molar. And then I constructed two schemes, and those were a relative and an absolute scheme based on Northern Scald collection. And the absolute scheme deals with the absolute ages of the reindeer in the Northern Scald collection. And the relative scheme deals with the relative ages, and this can be used on any reindeer population and can also be calibrated. I also tested the scheme for ease of applicability and inter-server bias on 11 observants. 5 observants were experienced, and this means that they already worked with the scheme many times before because they are zoo archaeologists. And the inexperienced users, they worked with a scheme like the one I showed you from Grant 1982 before, a couple of years back, but never did it again. So they were not experienced, but they knew how the concept worked. And then I gave them high quality pictures of 20 to 25 reindeer mandibles, of the occlusal surfaces, of the buccal, which is towards the lips, and the lingual, which is towards the tongue side. And also the pattern code, eruption pattern codes and the descriptions. After that, I applied the schemes, both of them, on the Etcheia collection of the 61 mandibles. To evaluate the performance of both the schemes. And finally, I decided to draw the schemes because in black and white because it makes them more objective. And the results you can see in this picture. So the results were fairly consistent between the experienced and inexperienced testers. The inexperienced testers estimated 69% of the mandibles within 1 year deviation of the real age, and the experienced testers tested 62% of the mandibles within 1 year deviation of the real age. And deviations of more than 2 years are very low for both tester groups. And these results demonstrate the user friendliness and also the ease of applicability of the scheme because there's a minor variation between experienced and inexperienced user groups. And regarding age justification, between 90 and 93% of the jaws were estimated within a 2 year deviation of the real age, so the age justification is fairly good. It was also found that the accuracy of the scheme decreases with increasing age, and that for the youngest age category, 92% of the mandibles were estimated within 1 year deviation of the real age, so that is fairly good. In the table you can see the age categories and then the deviations. So then I applied the absolute scheme on the Etcheia collection, and the absolute scheme scores very well for the two youngest age groups, which are 0 to 5 and 5 to 10 years old, and fairly well for the oldest age group, which is 10 to 17 years old. For the youngest age group, 96% of estimations are within a 1 year range of the real age, and for the second age group, 80% of the estimated ages are within a 1 year range. And for the oldest age group, about 60% of the estimations are within a 1 year range. So then I applied the relative scheme to the Etcheia collection to see how it performs But I found a prominent difference between the two. Namely, the prime age group is overestimated and the young age group is underestimated. And I found this pretty striking because the absolute scheme, it performs so well. So there are two reasons why this could have happened. The first is that there are different age classes, so it's harder to compare. And the second reason is that it could be due to an inherent fault in the calculation of the ages that hasn't been addressed before in only in any literature about two-variant eruption pattern schemes, so I'm a bit puzzled. Namely, how it works is that you decide the two-variant stage, which is on the left side of the picture, for a wear pattern, and then with that you can have a numerical equivalent. And then for all the teeth, you count them together to get a mandibular wear stage. And in the case of young individuals that still have the deciduous premolar 4, which is on the left side, when it's really worn, it can, for example, have a two-variant stage of G, and the numerical equivalent of that is 13. But if you have an older reindeer, which has not a deciduous anymore, but a premolar 4, that has, for example, two-variant stage B, then you have only numerical equivalents of 7. So when you calculate mandibular wear stages, the younger individual comes up older, and this has never been addressed. So I think we should probably do this from now on. And then this has to be changed, but I still have to test this. So as a conclusion, it was possible to establish a relative and absolute tooth-wear and eruption pattern scheme based on the molarity from teeth of the Northern Scott collection. The absolute scheme can be used to assess absolute ages of Svalbard reindeer from the 6 hunting grounds and the grounds, and the relative scheme can be used to estimate the age or death of any reindeer, but only relatively, but can be calibrated. The absolute scheme scored very well for ease of applicability and age justification. And there was also minor variation between the experienced and inexperienced users, and this proves the accuracy and also the user-friendliness of the scheme that we developed. And the best results are yielded within the youngest age categories, which is 0 to 5 years old. And the application of the absolute scheme to the Azure collection yielded even better results, with about 83% of the mandibles being estimated within 1 year deviation of the real age. And the majority of the Azure collection didn't even have a first molar, so that also proves the utility of the scheme for molars or for mandibles with one teeth missing, which is often the case in archaeological assemblages. And lastly, the calculations from the ages should be changed for the deciduous premolar 4, and this problem should be addressed in other studies concerning tooth wear and tooth eruption schemes. I would like to acknowledge many people, of whom my supervisor, Jeanette Tuyck-Hierler, the first one, and also the Catharine van Tussenbroek Foundation for granting me a scholarship so I could go to Oslo and visit the collection, and also Research School Argon for giving me the Argon Conference subsidy so I can present my results to you.